So Dr. Ritu Arora could not be here to give her talk on viral keratitis, so I'll be covering that topic. Meanwhile, if there are any questions on, okay. So there are no financial or proprietary interests, and viral keratitis can be in the form of herpetic eye disease or non-herpetic eye disease. Herpetic eye disease could be because of herpes simplex or herpes zoster, and non-herpetic eye disease could be adenoviral. And normally the primary HSV infection occurs in the mucocutaneous distribution of the cranial nerve 5 and via sensory nerve endings to the cell body of the trigeminal ganglia. It enters the nucleus of the neuron and it gets reactivated because of fever, hormonal changes, UV exposure, stress, trauma, eczema laser ablation, or even low immunity. And this can also lead to, and when these triggers are there, it can also lead to a recurrent form of ocular herpes. Now, the clinical features could be primary ocular herpes, which are confined to corneal epithelium. Also includes blepharoconjunctivitis with a preocular lymphadenopathy, or it could be recurrent ocular herpes, which could be epithelial, stromal, or endothelial. And this is just to show how epithelial keratitis looks like, and stromal and the endothelial with the desmoid membrane folds. Now, a case such as this, where possibly there's no lesion, but it looks as though there's no lesion, a patient is complaining of foreign body sensation, you should always stain with the fluorescein dye, because you may pick up dendrites which you otherwise don't see subtly on a slit lamp, on a gross slit lamp examination. So the dendrites, they look like this, and you can stain it with fluorescein as well as with the rose Bengal. And again, to show that a case which was looking like this, possibly not having any lesion, when you stain it, you can actually see geographical ulcers. And when you get these geographical ulcers, because the patient has been prescribed topical steroids in a case of herpetic keratitis. So whenever you have these geographical ulcers in cases of viral keratitis, you should always tell the patient to stop steroids. And almost 95% of the times when you ask the patient, are you using steroids, the answer would be yes. Herpes stromal keratitis can be there in the form of necrotizing stromal keratitis and immune stromal keratitis with the double immune ring of Wesley such as this. Apart from this, there could be herpes stromal keratitis and necrotizing stromal keratitis, where you can have deep vascularization, corneal thinning and perforation. And in the endothelitis picture with the disciform scar, which could be linear or it could be diffuse. Then herpes is a great mimicker, so it can mimic almost can mimic like any other thing, and it can also have a presentation of peripheral ulcerative keratitis. Now, there can be neurotrophic keratopathy as well, and the complications of this could be stromal scarring, neovascularization, and perforation. Then when it encroaches the trabecular meshwork, it can lead to secondary glaucoma, and it can also be accompanied by iridocyclitis, where you would have AC inflammation, patchy iris atrophy, posterior synechia, etc. Now for lab diagnosis, classically, although there are various tests defined, but what we are doing is the PCR, which gives you 70% specificity, and also ELISA, which is doable, which gives you 85% sensitivity. Now this is a single slide which depicts the treatment of herpes keratitis, herpes simplex keratitis. So if you have just epithelial keratitis, you have to give topical acyclovir 5 times a day for 1 week, and then 3 times a day for 21 days. If you have epithelial with stromal, wait for the epithelial to heal first. So you have to give treat just like you would treat epithelial stromal keratitis with a topical acyclovir. But after the epithelium heals or after 1 week, you add prednisolone to take care of the stromal. And then you taper both by 6 to 8 weeks. However, if it is necrotizing and non-necrotizing stromal herpes simplex keratitis, then the same treatment continues as for epithelial and stromal, that is in the previous row, except that you add systemic acyclovir 400 milligram 5 times a day for 1 week and 3 times a day for 1 week, and again gradual taper to prevent reactivation. Now for herpes endothelitis, topical steroids have to be given, and oral cyclovir 400 milligram 5 times a day may be added along with the topical cycloplegics. GAN cyclovir is a approved drug by FDA, and it comes as 0.15% aqueous gel. If you see the clinical studies, the results are similar, except that it is better tolerated as compared to topical acyclovir because it has less irritation, punctate keratitis, hyperemia, and less blurred vision. And oral acyclovir should be given in three case scenarios when there's recurrent stromal or epithelial keratitis. So when do you say it is recurrent? When there are more than three episodes in a year, when a patient gives you, then it is recurrent. In immunocompromised patients and in cases of HSV keratitis in a corneal graft. Now again, valacyclovir is a prodrug of acyclovir with a good bioavailability. And again, if you compare it with systemic acyclovir, the advantage is that there are few cases of GIT upset and headaches as compared to acyclovir. And also because the dosage is less frequent, so the patient compliance tends to be better. Now, oral ganciclovir in one study did show results better than oral acyclovir, which was statistically significant. Then in cases of metaherpetic keratitis, one has to withdraw the epithelial-toxic drugs, give intensive lubricants, cyclophlegics, and steroids. And again, for cases which are which where there is a neurotrophic component, you may have to do conjunctival flaps, multilayered amniotic membrane grafts, and tectonic grafts in those cases where there is perforation. There is Can you not switch off the light? Yeah. There is a topical acyclovir toxicity in these cases, which one should be aware of. And there are cases of acyclovir-resistant keratitis where intravenous foscarnate or topical cyclosporine are useful adjuncts. So this is just to show where topical steroids should be used and where oral steroids should be used, which I have already discussed with you. And coming to the next one, that is the herpes zoster keratitis. It can occur in two forms again, the primary and the recurrent, and classically there'll be vesicular lesions on the lid margins and also on the face along with the keratitis. And you can have microdendritic ulcers, disciform keratitis or pneumular keratitis such as seen here. When you compare the dendrites of the herpes simplex keratitis with herpes zoster, notice that the dendrites of herpes simplex are more better looking. They look more beautiful as compared to the dendrites of zoster, which are, you can say, ugly looking dendrites. So here it is excavated kind of a picture, whereas here it is as though somebody's painted something on the cornea or on the ocular surface. And there's minimal fluorescein staining with zoster keratitis, unlike herpes simplex keratitis, which would stain well. The treatment for varicella zoster would be oral acyclovir, 800 milligram 5 times a day for 10 to 14 days. And there's no role of topical acyclovir in these cases. For prevention, people even use live vaccine, zoster virus, more than 60 years of age, which decreases zoster and herpetic neuralgia, as well as severity, duration of pain, and discomfort. But the duration of protection with this vaccine is only for 4 years. So, thank you for your attention.